This is Professor Rogers. In this presentation, we summarize the use of Excel to find descriptive statistics in the analysis of numeric variables. We take a look at two different types of numeric descriptive statistics, arithmetic and positional, as well as the use of the descriptive statistics procedure in Excel. Arithmetic measures are determined by using basic arithmetic. Addition, subtraction, multiplication, and division. In contrast, positional measures are determined by where the number sits in the distribution. Each type of measure has its own measure of central tendency and measure of dispersion. The mean and standard deviation are the arithmetic measures of central tendency and dispersion, and the median and interquartile range are the positional measures. We will also look at some other statistics that can be used in conjunction with the measures of central tendency and dispersion. As an example, we use state-level data to determine the descriptive statistics for three variables: the violent crime rate, the imprisonment rate, and the poverty rate. Here is a screenshot of part of the data typed into an Excel spreadsheet. Each variable gets its own column. The violent crime rate is placed in column B, the imprisonment rate occupies column C, and the poverty rate is located in column D. Note that there is a fourth variable containing the name of the state in column A. This column is useful when setting up the data so one can keep track of the unit corresponding to each piece of information. But the state column is not otherwise used in this example. In the Excel spreadsheet containing the data, go to the Data tab at the top, and then in the ribbon for the Data tab, go to the far right and click on Data Analysis with the cursor. When you click on Data Analysis on the ribbon, you will get a dialog box listing the various procedures available in the Data Analysis toolpack. Move your cursor to Descriptive Statistics. When you click on Descriptive Statistics in the list of procedures, you get a dialog box for this group of statistics. We need to provide four pieces of information in the dialog box. First, select the columns of data to be used in the analysis. In the top of the box, you can put the range of cells from the spreadsheet into the Input Range box. By clicking on the icon on the right of the box, you get a box that automatically fills when you highlight the cells of the spreadsheet that you want. In my example here, I have highlighted cells B1 to D51, which contain the data for my three variables. Various versions of Excel highlight the selected areas in different ways. In this example, the area that I selected is surrounded by dashed lines, which are hard to see in this screenshot. Once the desired cells are selected, hit Return. Second, tell Excel how your variables are grouped on the spreadsheet. In this example, each column represents its own variable, so I select Grouped by Columns, which was the default option in this case. Third, tell Excel whether or not the variable names are included in the selected cells. In this example, the variable names are in the first row of the spreadsheet, and I included the first row earlier when I selected the cells I wanted. Thus, I must check the box for labels in first row. If the labels in first row option is not selected when labels are included in the data, I get an error message saying input range contains non-numeric data. As the final step, click on the box for summary statistics. This selection tells Excel to provide all the descriptive statistics for the three variables. Once the information for all four items is entered, click on the OK button in the upper right-hand corner. Here is the resulting output. It contains an extensive list of statistics for each of the three variables. I use two commands in the ribbon to clean up the output. I use the Format option to automatically set the width of each column, and I use the Number options to give all numbers two significant digits to the right of the decimal point. This cleanup is not required, but I like to work with nice-looking output whenever I can. Let's see what's in the output. Five different numeric descriptive statistics are highlighted on this slide. We will discuss each one. The count refers to the number of valid observations present for each variable. The count statistic is also sometimes referred to using the letter N. N stands for number. It is the count of the number of observations in the dataset. In this example, each variable has a count of 50, which means there is an observation for each of the 50 states. The count is not technically an arithmetic measure, but we need it to calculate some of the other arithmetic measures. Add all the values together and we get the sum. On the bottom is the equation for the sum. X subscript I means the ith value of the variable. There are a total of 50 possible i's, one for each observation. The squiggly thing is the Greek letter sigma capitalized. In mathematical notation, sigma stands for sum. Thus, the equation says we should add the values of all the 50 observations together to get the sum for each variable. Just a comment about the sum. The sum is not always a useful number, and the variables that we have here are examples of this. Let's take violent crime rate. If our variable were the number of violent crimes, the sum would be useful. However, in this case, the number of violent crimes has been standardized to form a population rate. So the number that we see, 17,634, has no intrinsic meaning and is not a useful description of the data. Nonetheless, we still need the sum because of its use in other calculations. The arithmetic measure of central tendency is the mean, or what could be called the arithmetic mean, or more commonly what we call the average. The mean is highlighted here on the output. The typical state has a mean violent crime rate of 352.68, an imprisonment rate of 404.48, and a poverty rate of 15.19%. On the bottom is the formula for the mean. The numerator of the mean is the sum. To get the mean, we divide the sum by the n. The mean is often symbolized using the Greek letter mu, or x, with a line over it, often called x bar for short. As an undergraduate, I was taught to use mu when speaking of the population mean and x bar when describing a sample mean. But I've seen this rule broken so many times that it is essentially meaningless. The measures of dispersion for arithmetic measures are the standard deviation and variance. The latter is referred to as the sample variance in this output. These two measures are related. The standard deviation is how far the typical point is from the mean. This distance between a point and the mean is sometimes called the error, which makes the standard deviation the average error around the mean. The variance is the square of the standard deviation. Many complex statistics are built on the N, the mean, and the standard deviation, so we need to take some time to understand the standard deviation in detail. We will look at the equation and also work through its calculation using a couple of data points. In the first step, we take the difference of every point from the mean of the distribution, then square it. Squaring it might seem strange, but this approach to distance is commonly used in Euclidean geometry. For example, you've probably seen the squaring of a difference to get a distance before with the Pythagorean theorem, which we all learned to use to calculate the sides of a triangle. Here I do this calculation on the violent crime rates for two states, California and Ohio. The x column is the violent crime rate for each state. The x minus x bar column is the distance between the point and the mean. The number is positive if the state's value is greater than the mean, and negative if the state's number is less than the mean. In the final column, we square the distances, which turns each number positive. Then we add up the squared distances. Notice the Greek letter sigma, which indicates sum. With our example, I did this calculation for all 50 states. Below the table is the sum of the squared distances for all 50 observations. Divide this total by n minus 1. This spreads the distance over the number of points in the distribution. One might think that the denominator should be n, but we subtract 1 to account for a degree of freedom. There are n points, and I have already used up 1 degree of freedom by identifying one fixed point, the mean, so the remaining number of points is n minus 1. There is no distance between the mean and itself, so the distances are spread over the remaining points. This number is also called the variance. In Excel, the variance number is included in the output. Here the variance is calculated for the example. For the final step, we take the square root of the variance, which undoes the squaring earlier. This gives us the standard deviation. The standard deviation is the measure of dispersion associated with the mean and refers to the average distance each point in the distribution is from the mean. It is symbolized by the Greek letter sigma or the English letter S. On the right of this slide, we see the full formula for the standard deviation. Let me break it down into steps. Here the standard deviation is calculated in the example. The output shows other statistics that are numeric. The standard error, which is often mistaken by students for the standard deviation, is discussed in conjunction with margins of error and confidence intervals. Kurtosis and skewness are topics related to whether the distribution is normal. All these issues are dealt with in different videos in this series. Positional metrics are also present in the output. The standard set of positional metrics, sometimes called the five-number summary, include the median, the 25th and 75th percentile points, and the minimum and maximum. There are two measures of dispersion. The range is the distance between the minimum and maximum, and the interquartile range is the distance between the 25th and 75th percentiles. The median is the measure of central tendency for positional metrics, and the interquartile range is the measure of dispersion, regarded as the positional equivalent of the standard deviation. Only three of the five numbers are present in the output: the median, minimum, and maximum. The only dispersion measure is the range. The 25th and 75th percentiles are calculated using the quartile function. Here I show the commands for the different elements of the five-number summary and also a screenshot of using the quartile command to calculate the median of the violent crime rate. In the cell where the quartile statistic will be calculated, start with an equal mark, which tells Excel you are doing an operation or function. Then type in the name of the function, which is quartile. Follow the function with parentheses with no space between the function and the parentheses. In the parentheses, enter the range of the variable for which you are calculating the statistics. The use of the colon here says use data from cell B2 to cell B51. Do not include the variable label in the first row. Follow the range with a comma and then put the number of the statistic that you wish to calculate. Those numbers can be seen in the chart in the upper left-hand corner. In my example, I entered 2 because I calculated the mean. I use 1 when calculating the 25th percentile and 3 for the 75th percentile. The interquartile range is calculated by hand as the difference between the 25th and 75th percentiles. In addition to the mean and median, there is a third measure of central tendency, the mode. The mode is the value with the largest number of observations. While one can use a mode with numeric data, it is recommended that you do not do so because numeric data can have multiple modes. Software packages provide only one mode. In this video, we have looked at both arithmetic and positional descriptive statistics and how to determine them in Excel. There are several uses for descriptive statistics. First, descriptive statistics can be used to describe a distribution of numbers simply. For example, the best way for me to tell you the violent crime rate of the 50 states is to tell you the rate for each and every state. This approach would require 50 numbers. We often get a good sense of a distribution simply by providing a measure of central tendency and dispersion, such as the mean and standard deviation. Second, descriptive statistics can be used to inspect the data for evidence of irregular patterns and problems, such as skewed distributions and outliers. Dealing with these problems is discussed elsewhere in this video series. Descriptive statistics are also used to determine whether the data needs cleaning. Sometimes missing data is marked with a large number. For example, if I did not know the crime rate of a specific state, I might put in a ridiculously large number, like 999,999, to indicate that data is missing. Strange numbers in the minimum, maximum, or mode can be signs of unusual coding of the data. Finally, descriptive statistics provide the foundation from which more complex statistics are calculated. Arithmetic statistics are particularly important as the basis for more complicated statistics.